Okay, so this is an introduction to organic chemistry at A level. It takes us through the first ideas to do with the subject, which we then build on in later topics. So the first question that we've got to ask ourselves is what do we mean by organic chemistry? And it really is all to do with carbon. Okay, so we are carbon-based life forms. So all of life basically on the earth is pretty much carbon based. There are theories about other possible types of life forms. So there's theories about silicon-based life forms. That's a hotly debated area. If you think about where silicon is on the periodic table, it's just below carbon. So the idea is that it should possess many of the features of carbon, but it's a little bit more complicated than that, because there are all sorts of thermodynamic and kinetic implications of changing from carbon to silicon. So we're really starting our exploration of organic chemistry in a way that you can think of as like learning a new language. So, you know, how we identify compounds, how we name compounds, these are all going to be very important to how we're able to develop our knowledge of organic chemistry throughout the A-level. So it might be a little bit of a struggle, just like learning a language can be, but the more you practice, the more that you work on it, it becomes much more intuitive, and by the end of the A-level, you'll just be doing it like that. So we've already commented on the fact that we're really focusing here on carbon and the different molecules that carbon forms. It forms strong, stable bonds. That's very important. And if you were able to look at a database of all the organic molecules that we know to exist, there would be, I mean, this is thousands, there would be millions. There would be just an incredible number. And that, at first glance, can feel a little bit bewildering. But once we learn the rules of organic chemistry, once we learn key features of organic compounds, then actually we're talking about a much smaller number in terms of understanding organic reactions. So hopefully you remember the term homologous series from your GCSE. It should have been something that you came up against in that. And we're talking about families of organic compounds. It's these families that are going to make our life actually a lot easier. So what do we mean? What do they have in common? What makes them a family? Well, typically they have the same general formula, although I am just going to caveat that slightly, because things aren't always that straightforward, as we'll discover. They certainly have similar chemical properties. That's very, very important. And that's one of the things that we're going to be focusing on when we look at individual families later in the course. In a series within a family of compounds, so in this homologous series, each member of that series is going to differ by the addition of a CH2 group. So basically, the carbon chain becomes longer. And there is also a gradual change in physical properties. And so by physical properties, we typically mean things like melting and boiling point. So here are just three examples of families or homologous series. So at the top, we've got alkanes. We're going from one carbon, two carbons, three carbons as we go from left to right. And if you think about the change, if I just write the formula underneath, so we've got CH4, C2H6, and C3H8. If you consider what the difference between them is, there is a CH2 difference, okay, which is one of the things that we mentioned. If we look at the second, this is alcohol. So these are alcohols. That's the homologous series. Again, if I write the molecular formulae, C2H6O, C3H8O. And again, if you look at the difference between those formulae, as we go along the series, there's a difference by CH2. And then at the bottom, we've got alkenes. Okay, and then again, if I write the formulae, so I've got C2H4, C3H6. And then finally C4H8, and again, if we look at the difference between them, it's CH2, just as we said before. So how did I know it was alkanes at the top? How did I know they were alcohols in the middle? And how did I know that they were alkenes at the bottom? So we'll talk about alkanes in a minute, but the thing that hopefully prompted us to see straight away they were alcohols was the fact that we had this common OH group here. And then with alkenes, the thing that hopefully stood out for us and we saw was common to all of them was the carbon-carbon double bond. Now, in the case of the alcohols and the alkenes, we would call those, the OH and the C double bond C, a functional group. And it's that part of the molecule that gives those compounds their particular chemical properties. So all alcohols will react in a particular way, barring a few exceptions when we come to those actual topic areas, and ditto alkenes as well. So we're just going to go through some of the different families or some of the different homologous series. So starting with alkanes, the sort of, I guess, the simplest in a way. They're fully saturated. Now, what we mean by fully saturated is that they contain single bonds only, or another way of putting it, it's that there are no double or triple carbon-carbon bonds. Every carbon has four bonds. That's actually typical of organic molecules. They do have a general formula of CnH2n plus 2. That was obviously something that you did at GCSE. And we can tell if something is an alkane or not because it has ane as the suffix part of its name. So just to give a couple of examples, just very simple ones. So we have methane, for example, we can tell it's an alkane because it ends in ane, and ethane. So those are the first two actually in the series. So alkenes are unsaturated. So by unsaturated, we mean that they contain the carbon-carbon double bond. That's what we mean by unsaturated here. Again, it's four bonds per carbon atom. The general formula is slightly different. When I said earlier about how we just had to caveat the general formula a little bit, and we're going to discover that there's another type of, well, there's actually a type of alkane which has that same general formula. So we're just going to be a little bit careful of that. And we can see that we can recognize, if something's an alkene or not, because in its name at the end as the suffix, it'll have ene in it as well. So if we just come up with some examples again of that. So the smallest alkene is ethene. So look, it ends in ene. And then we've got propene. So on. Okay, so this is brand new, so this is not something that you would have covered at GCSE. So I want to look at the fact that it has two parts to its name. So it has the halo part and it has an alkane part. Okay, so it's the halo bit that's really the interesting bit. So what that means is that it contains that our molecule contains a halogen. Okay, so that could be fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine. Typically, we don't go beyond that. We don't go to astatine. The alkane part tells us it's fully saturated. So if it wasn't a haloalkane, if it was a haloalkene, we'd actually be looking at two different functional groups. So for the moment, we're just focusing on the functional group that affects the reactivity of that particular compound and the fact that the halogen was bonded or was part of this molecule would affect its reactivity. So because we're saying it's an alkane, it's still fully saturated, single bonds only, no double or triple carbon-carbon bonds. As before, four bonds per molecule, and then the functional group will be a halogen attached to a carbon. One interesting thing, and obviously we're going to explore this in much greater detail, is when naming a haloalkane, there is no change to the suffix. So it's the start of the name that will contain the halogen. So if I just pick a very simple molecule, if just for example, fluoromethane. Okay, so we can see the alkane part. So we've got the ane for the alkane part, and then we've got the fluoro for the halo part. Next, alcohols. So you would have covered those briefly at GCSE. The thing that makes them an alcohol, the functional group, is the OH group. That's the functional group. If it can be identified either as a suffix, so like ethanol, for example, so the ol bit at the end, but depending on whether there are other functional groups, and you will come across molecules at A level where you have an OH group and another functional group. Typically then, if there's a second functional group, quite often the alcohol becomes part of the name in the form hydroxy. Okay, so if you see hydroxy in an organic molecule, it means there's an OH group. So again, if we pick some examples, just in terms of names, ones that you're familiar with, we've got ethanol. Okay, so it's the ol that tells us it's an alcohol. But just while we're here, what we benefit from is the fact it just say AN here. So that tells us that the rest of the molecule is saturated. So that's making it clear that the rest of the molecule is in effect an alkane, and there are no other functional groups in this particular example. So just a pause before we carry on with further homologous series. Something that we use as a shorthand or an abbreviation in organic chemistry is this letter R. Okay, so rather than sometimes writing an entire molecule out, if we just want to be focusing or highlighting a particular part of it, we might use R as an abbreviation. Okay, so what R represents or stands for is, well, we call it a hydrocarbon chain or an alkyl group. So, for example, and I appreciate this is slightly jumping ahead in a way. So R could represent, for example, CH3, CH3, CH2. These are going to be examples of alkyl groups, which we'll come back to, and so on and so on. So, for example, this molecule here that we've got with the carbon-oxygen double bond might have been something like CH3, C double bond O. Oh dear, that's not very clear. CH2, CH3. So instead of writing the CH3, we've written R. And because we want to make it clear that the other group attached to the same carbon is different, we've used R dash. Okay, so let's try and show that a little bit more clearly. So this is the common feature to both of those molecules, the carbon double bond to an oxygen. Our R group here was our methyl group, and our dash was our ethyl group. But it's just a shorthand. It's just to say, if you see an R group, you know that it's a carbon chain of some sort. It might only be one carbon in length, might be two, three, doesn't matter. Just think of it as another carbon that's attached. So here's a brand new homologous series called aldehydes. Their functional group is the carbon double bonded to an oxygen. And that is called a carbonyl group. Okay, now if we know it's an aldehyde, or if we're told it's an aldehyde, we know that that carbonyl is on the final carbon of the chain. And we can tell that's the case because one of the groups attached to that carbonyl group is actually just a hydrogen. Okay, that tells us then that we're at the end of a carbon chain. Just notice the naming. We won't really deal with the prefix oxy at A level, so we can sort of ignore that. And you can see that the suffix is AL. So examples of an aldehyde would be something like ethanol or propanol. So it's very similar to an alcohol's name, just the difference is instead of an O, we have an A. So just be very careful about that when in both pronouncing things, writing things, etc., etc. So ketones have the same functional group as an aldehyde. They're actually going to react in exactly the same way, but we do differentiate between them for reasons that will become clearer later in the course. But how they're different from an aldehyde is that that carbonyl group is somewhere along the chain, but not at the end. Okay, so again, the prefix would be oxy. We're not really going to come across that at A level. And so we'll recognize a ketone actually from its suffix, which is "-one". So an example of a ketone is propanone. And finally for now, we've got carboxylic acids, which was a family or homologous series you did do very briefly at GCSE. So they contain the group COOH, that's the functional group. So you'll notice that is always at the end of a chain. We recognize carboxylic acid in its name from having oic acid as part of its name. So for example, and again, I'll pick the simplest. Actually, this isn't the simplest. Ethanoic acid, simplest would have been, or is, methanoic acid. So we're now going to go through the rules as defined by the International Union of Pure and Applied Chemistry. So you are quite likely to see in exam questions and in various other places this term IUPAC, and basically they are the people who set down consistent rules as to how we go about doing certain things. So one of those is naming compounds. So the first rule we've got to follow is that we've got to try and identify the longest unbranched chain. So then that is the highest number of consecutive carbons that we can jump from one to another, to another, to another, to another. And that's going to give us the stem name. So you've come across the first four stem names at GCSE. So you knew that if an alkane was one carbon, it was methane. And if an alkane was two carbons, it was ethane. And three, propane, and four, butane. So these are the stem names, depending on how many carbons there are in the longest unbranched chain. By unbranched chain, it just means consecutive number of carbons. We're going to look at some examples and apply this, but we've got all the way up to eight here. But I'm just going to add 9 and 10. So 9 is non, and 10 is dec. Okay, right. So once we've identified the longest unbranched chain, we're going to try and identify any substituent groups. So what that means is anything that's attached to that longest unbranched chain. And if there are more, if there's more than one, when we write the name at the end, we're going to put those substituent groups in alphabetical order. So for the moment, we're going to just consider carbon constituent groups. So these are also called alkyl groups. So I will just write that here. So they are sometimes called alkyl groups. So if it was a methyl group, i.e. a CH3, that would be our substituent. Ethyl is CH3, CH2, and so on and so on. Okay, this will make more sense in a minute when we look at an example. And finally, we've got to identify the position of these substituents, and we're going to do this by a number. So these substituents could be attached to this longest chain in different places, and we need to make it clear where those places are, and we're going to do that by using numbers. Okay, so we're going to look at an example. So the first thing that we've got to do is find out what the longest unbranched chain is. So going from one carbon to another. So I'm just going to start at the end of the left, and I'm going to go, and I can go to this one, and then so on and so on. So I could go, that's one, that's the longest unbranched chain. I could actually, and just to make it clear, it doesn't always have to be linear. I could have done this just to show that they're the same. If I count the number of carbons, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Six. Okay, so the next thing we do is we identify whether there are any substituent groups attached to that longest chain, and we can see that we've got a methyl group. And in fact, actually, we've got two methyl. Well, we can, if we look at the one at the bottom, we've also got a methyl group. And then finally, we're going to work out the position. Now, when we do work out the position, we actually try and focus on the smallest number. So what I'm just going to do is just rub out those numbers that I've currently got, and I'm now going to write them from the other end. So it's still, you know, six carbons is still the longest unbranched chain, but the reason for doing this was that I wanted to make the number for the substituent as small as I could. So you're not automatically counting from left to right. You have to count so that your the values, the numbers for your substituents are as small as possible. So I'm just going to name this. So I have, on the second carbon, I have a methyl group. And then I have a six carbon chain. So that's hex. And then because the molecule is a saturated, fully saturated compound, it's an alkane. And so I'm just going to add the ane to say it's an alkane. So this structure is 2-methylhexane. So this is just to confirm that the numbering is done from the end of the chain that gives the lowest number for the substituent groups, probably is a better way of putting it. So for the substituent groups as opposed to of the substituent groups. Now it's possible that you can have more than one substituent group and more than one of the same type of substituent group. So we could have had 2-methyls or could have had 3-methyl substituent groups attached on that. And in those cases, we make it clear that that's the case by using di. So it would be dimethyl if it was 2-methyls, trimethyl if there were 3-methyls, and tetramethyl if there were 4-methyls. And then finally, you already saw that dashes separate words and numbers. Actually, it's really what I should have here. Sorry about that. So commas separate numbers. So if we have two numbers next to each other, it will be a comma between the numbers. And then if we have a number and a word, they are separated by dashes, and words aren't separated at all, as we'll see. So I will sort of remind you of this as we look at specific examples. Okay, so rule one is about the longest chain or the longest consecutive number of carbons. So I could do it like that. So I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Or I could consider it like this. I know that's the same because that also gives, that's also 9 consecutive carbons. So I'll go back to the original version. Okay, so I've got 9 consecutive carbons, and it's a fully saturated compound. So I know that the end of the name of my compound is going to be nonane. Okay. So in rule two, we're identifying substituents. So let's just again show the main branch or the main stem there. Sorry, not branch, main stem. And stuck onto it, I've got a methyl group there, a methyl group there, and I have an ethyl group here. So I have 1-ethyl group. So I'll do that in alphabetical order, and 2-methyl groups. Okay. So next, I've got to think about numbering those substituent groups. So remember, we do the substituent groups in alphabetical order. So it's going to be ethyl, and then it's going to be dimethyl. When we talk about alphabetical order, we're talking about the letter of the group, so the M in methyl. So the fact that it's dimethyl, because there are two of them, that D does not now take priority in the alphabetical order. It's still a methyl group, or they're still methyl groups. So ethyl is going to come first, so I want that to be the lowest number. So I'm going to start counting from the left. So I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay, so there's my nonane. So I have got a 1-ethyl on the third carbon. All right. And I've got 2-methyls. And they are on the 5th and 8th carbon. Okay. So the name of this compound is 3-ethyl. So remember, dashes separate numbers and words. Then it is 5-8 because the methyl substituents are on the 5th and 8th. Carbon, there's two of them, so dimethyl, and then our longest unbranched chain, and it's an alkane, so non for the number of carbons, 9, and ane because it's a alkane. So look, dash has separated or separates numbers and words, and we've got that there too, and then commas, so So commas separate numbers. And then there is no separation of words. So you go straight dimethyl nonane. Okay, so I'm going to want you to just pause the video in a second, and I want you to try and name these compounds. So try and follow those rules that you've just been, I've just hopefully explained. Try and name each of these compounds, and then I will take you through what their actual names are and how we would work that out. If you have any queries, once I've done that, just let me know. But otherwise, pause the video and give it a go. Okay, so let's start with the top left. The most number of consecutive carbons that I can do is 3. I could do that in different ways, but it doesn't matter. So we know that our molecule is a prope. Okay, and we can see it's fully saturated, so the last part of the name is going to be propane. Attached to that chain, we've got a methyl group, and we've got another methyl group. Okay, so we've got 2 methyls, so it's going to be dimethyl. Now, in terms of numbering, it's clear that it's on the second carbon. The thing is, we don't actually have to include the number on this particular name, because for a 3-carbon chain to have 2 methyl groups attached to it, they can only be on the second carbon. And because they can only be on the second carbon, we don't have to include the numbers in the name. So really, the name of this compound here is dimethyl propane. To put 2-2 is superfluous, because for it to be dimethyl propane, those methyl groups can only be on the second carbon, because if they were on the first or the third, it wouldn't be propane anymore, because we would have a greater number of consecutive carbons. If you don't believe me, try it out. Okay, let's look at the top right one. So the longest or the highest number of consecutive carbons that I can count is this. So that's 6 of them. Again, it's a saturated compound, so it's going to be hexane. We do have 1 methyl substituent group. So we want to count so that the number for that substituent group is the lowest number it can be. So we're going to count from this end. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, so that just confirms it's 6 carbons. So we have got 3 methyl hexane. Remember, look, dashes separate numbers and words. Okay, what about the one at the bottom? So I can do it, count the most number of carbons like this, or like this. It doesn't matter, because they're both 6. Again, it's a saturated compound. It's going to be hexane. Thinking about substituents, there's a methyl group and there is an ethyl group. Okay. We want to be counting so that those substituents are have the lowest number they possibly can. So I'm going to count from this end. So it's the 3rd carbon. If I counted from the other end, it would have been the 4th carbon. And so 3 is lower than 4. So the name of this compound is 3-ethyl-3-methyl-hexane. So remember, ethyl comes before methyl because it's alphabetical order. And they're both 3. Dashes separate numbers and words. So 3-ethyl-3-methyl-hexane. Okay. So looking at the last one, I could have the longest chain like this, or like this. They're both 9 carbons, so it doesn't really matter. That means it's going to be nonane. Looking at the substituents, wow, there's quite a few. So I've got an ethyl group here, got a methyl group here, methyl group there, methyl group there, methyl group there. So I want, it's alphabetical order, so ethyl comes before methyl, so I want the ethyl group to have the lowest number, so I'm going to count from the top end, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8, 9. I think it really does help actually to write numbers on your chains, to makes it a lot easier. Okay, so have I got space to write the actual answer? You have a quick decision, or double check that you're happy with your answer, and then I'll write mine. So just pause the video. So we have 3-ethyl-5-5-7-7-tetramethyl-nonane. So we know that our main branch, or our longest chain, is 9 carbons, and we know it's a saturated compound, so it's nonane. We have 4 methyl groups, that's why we've got tetramethyl. Those methyl groups are on, 2 of them are on the 5th carbon, but we have to make it clear that 2 of them are on the 5th carbon, which is why we've got 5-5. And 2 of them are on the 7th carbon, which is why we have to say 7-7 to make sure that it's clear that 2 of them are on that 7th carbon. And then we have an ethyl group on the 3rd carbon. So that gives us our whole name. Okay, so we're going to step things up a little bit here. Everything we've been looking at so far has been an alkane. But it could have been an alcohol, it could have been an aldehyde, a ketone. I know you're more familiar with some of these than others, but that's what we're going to consider now. And so it's like an extension. So if we knew that it was an alcohol and we knew it was 6 carbons, then we would have hexanol, although we would have to make it clear whereabouts the OH group was. So we would still insert a number in that. So it could be hexan-1-ol because it was on the 1st carbon, hexan-3-ol because it was on the 3rd carbon, and so on. Our substituents aren't necessarily just alkyl groups, no, so not just necessarily methyl, not just necessarily ethyl, etc. I am actually just going to scrub out the ones at the bottom because they're not really going to be relevant to us, really. So I'm just going to scrub those out because they're just going to get confusing. So I'm sorry about that. But certainly if it was a halogen, we would be looking at fluoro, chloro, bromo, iodo, and although we're not likely to come up against NO2 for a while, that would be a nitro substituent group. So if we just look at an example, if we think of halogen or alkanes, so they are alkanes with a halogen attached to them, and if you remember back, you know, I don't know, 10, 15, 20 minutes ago, we talked about how the halogen was always a prefix. So it'll be a fluoro something, chloro something, bromo something, iodo something. So pick the simplest possible, or in terms of number of carbons, example here. I've got 2 chlorines. So there is no need to number which carbon it's on. If I say it's methane, there's only 1 carbon. So it's clear what carbon the halogen has to be attached to. But this example here would be dichloro, because there are 2 chlorines, methane, and the methane because... meth tells us it's 1 carbon, and the ane tells us it's a fully saturated compound. So dichloromethane in this example. So if you could maybe get a piece of paper now and have a go at drawing the displayed formulae for the following structures. So by displayed formulae, it just means show every bond. We're going to talk about that a little bit more later, but you're going to be showing every bond in these structures. So that's mostly what we've been looking at up to this point anyway. So pause the video, have a go at writing these, and then I'll draw them. Okay, so here are my answers. Sorry, it's a little bit cramped and not always the clearest. So if you're not sure about anything, please ask me. But if you look at the first one, 1-bromobutane, the bute tells us we have 4 carbons. And we're told that we have a bromine on the first carbon. So 1-bromobutane. Look at the second one, the prop tells us we have 3 carbons, the ane tells us it's fully saturated, and 2-chloro, there's a chlorine on the second carbon. Okay, the third one, 1-chloromethylpropane. Now, okay, so this is an interesting one. So they tell us it's prop, so we're going to have 3 carbons as our main chain. They tell us that there's a chlorine on the first carbon. Now, they don't give us a number for the methyl. In fact, it looks like it's saying 1-chloro and methyl is 1, but if that was the case, it would be 1-chloro-1-methyl. Okay, so the fact is it's not giving us a number for the methyl group. Because the methyl group is attached to a 3-carbon chain, it has to be the second carbon. Okay, so they don't have to give us the number because that's the only place it can be. So 1-chloro-methyl-propane. If we look at D, they tell us bute, the longest chain is 4 carbons. They tell us we have an iodine on the second carbon, and that we have a methyl on the same carbon, also the second carbon, but it's the same carbon. Of course, I could have drawn it from the right, I could have counted from the right hand side, and then I would have had to have had those one carbon along. Let's look at 3-chloro-2-methylpentane. So the pent tells us it's 5 carbons, the ane means it's fully saturated. We have 3-chloro, so chloro before methyl because of alphabetical order, however it is in the middle, so it has to be the third carbon. And so we have a choice then, in terms of our counting, do we count from the left or from the right? Well, we always want the numbers to be as low as they can. We can't make 3 any lower because 3 is right bang in the middle. But we have a choice between 2-methyl or 4-methyl. So we're going to go for 2-methyl. Okay, so we're going to be counting from the right in this particular one. And then lastly, we have 2-bromo-2,4-dimethylhexane. So the hex and the ane tells us, well, the hex tells us it's 6 carbons along the longest consecutive number of carbons. The ane tells us it's fully saturated. We've got a bromine on the second carbon. We have a methyl also on the second carbon. Okay. And then we also have a methyl on the fourth carbon. So 2-bromo-2,4-dimethylhexane. So we know already that we recognise an alcohol from having an OH group present. So the name of this particular alcohol on the left here would be propan-2-ol. Okay. And so if we just go through that name, the prop is because we have 3 carbons. The an tells us that it's fully saturated, it's single carbons. And then the 2-ol is telling us that the alcohol group is on the second carbon. So here the exercise is to try and match the letter with the number. So I want you to pause the video and have a think about which one of these letters is pentan-3-ol, which one of these letters is propan-1-ol, and so on and so on. Okay, so just pause the video and then we'll look at the answers. Okay, so rather than just give you the answers, let's, actually name these different compounds. So if we look at A, we can see that there are 5 carbons, and we can see that we have one alcohol group on the third carbon, so that means we must have pentan-3-ol. So 1 matches with A. If we now look at B, we've got 2 carbons, so that's obviously F, and we've got, where's my colours there? We've got 2 OH groups, and they are both on the same carbon, and we are going to number those carbons 1 and 2. So this is ethan, and it's a diol because there's 2 alcohol groups, and they're both on the first carbon. So it's ethan 1,1-diol. So B matches with 4. Okay, so if we look at C, the longest chain that we've got is 4 carbons. Our alcohol group, so that's bute. Our alcohol group is on the second carbon, so it's butan-2-ol. And we have also a methyl group on the second carbon, so 2-methyl-butan-2-ol. So C matches with 3. Looking at D, we have 3 carbons, so that's obviously prop. We have an OH on the first, the second, and the third carbon. So it's a triol because there's 3 OH groups, and they are on the 1, 2, and 3rd, or 1st, 2nd, and 3rd carbon, sorry. So it's going to be propan 1,2,3 triol. So D matches with 6. Looking at E, we've got 2 carbon chains, so it's F. We've got an OH group on the first and the second carbon. So it's ethan 1,2-diol, so E matches with 5. So obviously F must be 2, but let's just confirm that. So we have 3 carbons, so that's prop. We have an OH group on the first, so it's propan 1-ol. Okay. All right, so what about alkenes then? So we've got a structure on the right there. We're just going to name that first. So the consecutive carbons. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we've got 6. We can, the carbon-carbon double bond's actually in the middle, so we can count from either end, but we're going to count from the left just for the purpose of this. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, so we know this is hex, and we know it's an alkene, so it's hexene, but we have to say where that carbon-carbon double bond is, and we use the number from where the carbon-carbon bond starts. So it starts on the third carbon. So the name of this is going to be hex-3-ene. Notice, again, dashes separate words and numbers. So hex-3-ene. So have a look at the ones on the left, please. And pause the video, and then I'll write the answers. And Okay, so here are the answers. So we're just going to go through them quite quickly. So propene, so prop tells us that there are 3 carbons, and we haven't got a number for where our carbon-carbon double bond is, and that's because in propene it can only ever be on the first carbon. So even if I'd put it on the right-hand side, I would have counted from the right-hand side, it still would have been the first carbon. Okay, bute-1-ene, so bute tells us that we have 4 carbons, and the ene tells us there's a carbon-carbon double bond, and the 1-ene tells us that the carbon-carbon double bond starts on the first carbon. Bute-2-ene, again it's bute, so 4 carbons. The ene tells us there's a carbon-carbon double bond, and the 2 tells us that it starts on the second carbon. I haven't drawn pent-1-ene because I didn't have enough space. You should have a five carbon chain, and you should have a carbon-carbon double bond at one end of the chain, and then have the right number of hydrogens attached to those carbons. Hex-1,4-diene. So the hex tells us there are 6 carbons. Diene tells us there are 2 carbon-carbon double bonds. And the 1,4 tells us that one of those carbon-carbon double bonds starts at the first carbon and the other starts at the fourth carbon. And then methylpropene, the prop tells us there are 3 carbons in that's the longest chain that we have, sorry. We don't have a number for the carbon-carbon double bond because it can only really be in one place, and we don't have a number for the methyl group because it can only really be in one place. So we have methylpropene. If you have any questions, just email me and ask me. Okay, so a real challenge now. I want you to try and name this compound. So pause the video and then go about trying to name it. Okay. Right, so let's start with the longest chain that we can do. So I reckon that's the longest chain. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 carbons, so we know we're going to have none. What class is it? Well, we've got a carbon-carbon double bond, and we've also got an alcohol group. Okay, so we know it's none. We know it's N because of the carbon-carbon double bond, and we know it's ol. That OH group, whichever end I count from, whether it's the top right or the bottom right, that OH group is on the fifth carbon. But my carbon-carbon double bond is now going to determine which end I count from. So I'm going to count from the top right. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 9. Okay, so the final part of our name is going to be non, because it's 9 carbons. 3N, because the N because there's a carbon-carbon double bond, and the 3 tells us it's on the third carbon. And then 5-ol, because we have an OH group, an alcohol group, on the fifth carbon. So now we need to look at our substituents. So we've got 2 bromines on the first carbon, we've got a methyl group on the third, and a methyl group on the fifth. And that's it, right? So we've got bromo and methyl. So bromo comes first because we do it in alphabetical order. So it's going to be 1,1-dibromo, 3,5-dimethyl. Wow, managed to fit that perfectly. So that is a ridiculous compound, and you will never have anything like that in even at A-level, the final A-level exam. But it does at least, I think, show you how far you've come already. Even if you didn't get it exactly right, if you've been able to follow how I've named it, it shows you already how far you've progressed just in this video. Okay, so we're just going to look very quickly at this question. So before we answer it, let's actually draw propanone. So we know that a ketone has a carbonyl group, and it has a carbon attached to, well, a carbon either side of that carbonyl group. It's prope, so it's only three carbons in total. Okay, so we don't put a number for the carbonyl and propanone, because by definition a ketone has to have its carbonyl group within a chain and not at the end of a chain, and there is only one place it can possibly go if you have three carbons, and that's the middle carbon. So we don't have, just like with propene, we didn't have to number the carbon-carbon double bond, we don't have to number the carbonyl in propanone either. Okay, so we're near the end of this first video, but we just have to do a little bit more on how we represent molecules. So we're going to talk about different formulae. So the first one is molecular formula, or formulae. The thing is, they only tell us the number of atoms. They don't tell us anything about the structure. So if you look at the bottom there, ethanol C2H6O, fine, and propanone C3H6O. Now that doesn't actually tell us it's propanone, because if I was to do the if I was to write the molecular formula for propanol, so that's the aldehyde, so propanol, it would be exactly the same. So having a molecular formula C3H6O does not tell us very much about the compound, other than it has three carbons, six hydrogens, and one oxygen. So it tells us the number of atoms of each element, but nothing more. So much better is structural formulae. So that shows us much better how the atoms are bonded. So we've got two examples here, ethanol and ethene. But why don't I just show you propanone and propanol. So the molecular formulae of those were identical, but how would their structural formulae look? So if I do propanone first, okay, and if I just draw the structure like this, because I did draw it before. So I would represent that as CH3COCH3. If I do propanol, okay, that has the structural, if I draw the structure like this, sorry about this, it's a bit cramped. I would draw that, or do that, the structural formula for this would be, okay, which is quite different. I would know that this was a ketone because of that, and I would know that the second was an aldehyde because of that. So structural formulae gives us a much more clear, much clearer picture of how the atoms are actually arranged, okay? So if you want to just have a go then at writing the structural formulae for pentane and methyl butane, based on what you think it's going to be, you might make a mistake, you probably will make a mistake, that's not the point. The point is to give it a go, and then when I write it out for you, hopefully to say, oh yeah, okay, I understand why I should have done it like that if you got it wrong. So I'm now going to write these as structural formulae. So CH3, CH2, 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 CH3. Just to make that clear. So this is this. And this is this. And this is this. And this is this. And this is this. So hopefully you can see how that they're translating across. Methyl butane is going to be CH3, CH2, CH bracket CH3, and then CH3. So again, if I try and show those why they are that, so this part is that. This part is that. This part is that, but attached to that is a methyl group. Okay. And then at the end, we have this. So structural formulae makes it much clearer exactly how the atoms are arranged. So display formula, we've actually been using these pretty much through most of this video, but we just haven't really referred to it as display formulae. They show every atom and every bond and exactly how they're connected. And the reason we don't do this all the time is actually it's really quite time consuming to write all of these out, which is why actually structural formulae basically is a simplified version of this. One thing to just watch out for, so in an exam, they may ask you to draw the display formulae for or formula for a compound. So you have to remember it is all bonds, and where people often make mistakes is, and if I use the alcohol here as an example, they would have written that, they probably would have written it on their answer as OH like that. And the thing is, that is wrong, because that is not showing every bond, okay? So that's a warning for the future. Okay, so the final thing we're looking at is skeletal formulae. So you probably see on films and in online, and you'll probably see skeletal formulae much more commonly, and you haven't really thought about what it meant. Because again, it's a way of showing things much more easily. So we don't actually show the carbon atoms. So a straight line is a carbon-carbon single bond, so a single straight line. And if it was a double line, it would be a double bond. We don't include the hydrogens, but we think about how many bonds carbon always must have. It must always have four carbons in an organic molecule. So for every bond that we can't see, that would mean there was a hydrogen. So if I just try and explain that or show that. So we said the carbon atoms aren't shown, all right, but where they are on our skeletal formulae is there would be one here, 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 and here. These would be our carbon atoms. We're not showing the hydrogen atoms, but they are, so they're omitted, but they've still got to be there. So we have a hydrogen, essentially, there must be four bonds. Every carbon must have four bonds. So if you, depending on how many bonds you've got shown on your skeletal formula, the remainder must be hydrogens. So if we start here, there would be three hydrogens. Here, there would be two, because that now gives us four bonds from that carbon. Here, where there would be one. Here, there would be three. Okay, and then here it would be three. Okay, just looking at the one on the right, so each like point is a carbon. All right, so there are six carbons, and every one of those points currently has two lines or two bonds from it. So we know that each of those carbons has two hydrogens attached. Okay, wouldn't draw these on. These are just really to explain what we can deduce from a skeletal formula. All right, so maybe this is putting you right into the deep end, but just have a look at these molecules and think about how you would name them based on your knowledge so far. And then we'll have, pause the video, and then we'll have a look at them together. OK, Okay, so we follow the same rules as we've always done. What's the longest number of consecutive carbons we can do? So, four. One, two, three, four, yeah. And we've got one substituent, which is a methyl group. What about the... So that is going to be two methyl butane. If that's not clear, so basically, look, we've got a carbon there, carbon there, carbon there, carbon there, and a carbon here. Okay. What about the next one? Longest unbranched chain. And we've got substituent. And, oh gosh, well, that's also 2-methylbutane. Okay, so don't be thrown by the way the sort of it's been drawn. If we follow our rules, okay, there's our carbons. So the longest carbon chain is 4. If we were counting them, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so we can see why it's 2. Let's just do that on that one there. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. Okay, what about the bottom left? Longest chain, 4. Got a methyl substituent. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4. Guess what? That is also 2-methyl butane. And we can probably guess what the final one's going to be now, but let's just confirm. Longest chain, substituent. 1, 2, 3, 4 for counting what the smallest number. So guess what? It is also 2-methyl butane. This shows how the rules are really, really, really good. So we can all draw these things in slightly different ways. I mean, and correctly. But if we follow our rules in terms of naming compounds, we will get the right answer or the right name. Okay, so this is asking you to convert structural formulae into name. So this is an interesting one. You pause the video. I'm not pausing the video. You pause the video, have a think about it, and then we'll look at the answer. Remember, the things in brackets are going to be substituents, okay? So the things in brackets are substituents, and they are attached to the carbon that is just before them, okay? So looking at the first one, what's the longest carbon chain? Okay, so we have got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And actually, if we were counting where that's... So we've got one substituent group, sorry. So we've got an ethyl group substituent. If we were counting... Actually, it doesn't matter which side we count from because it would be the fourth carbon that our substituent is attached to. So, if we were counting from the right, it would still be 1, 2, 3, 4. So, our first molecule must be 4-ethyl and then heptane. Okay, so ethyl group is our substituent. It's on the fourth carbon. The longest consecutive number of carbons is 7, that's hept, and it's fully saturated, so heptane. So let's look at the second one. So this is our chain. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, and then we've got substituents, a methyl, and an ethyl. And ethyl comes before methyl, but actually... let's try and make this a little bit clearer. So these substituent groups here are actually bonded to the same carbon, which is this one here. Right, so numbering, lowest number, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. If we counted from the right-hand end, the ethyl would have been 4, not 3. So naming it, we have got 3-ethyl, and then we have a methyl on the second and the third carbon. So it's going to be 2-3, and then there's two of them, so dimethyl. And then it's 6 carbons, so hexane, because it's fully saturated. Okay, let's look at the third one. So these are the consecutive carbons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6 again. So hex again. Substituents, a methyl and a methyl. But look at that, there's 2 methyls on that third carbon. I am going to count from that end. Okay. So we have 1 methyl on the second carbon and 2 on the third. So 2, 3, 3, right? For every methyl, we've got to give a number. There's 3 of them, so trimethyl. And then there were 6 carbons and they're saturated, so hexane. Okay. And then the fourth one, so our longest consecutive number of carbons is there. So that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 again. We have, again, a methyl and methyl with, well, actually 2 methyls on that carbon. We're going to be counting from the right-hand end this time because we want the number of the methyl substituents to be as small as possible. Okay, so when we're naming it now, it is 2, 2, 3. So we have 2 methyls on the second carbon, 1 methyl on the third, trimethyl again, hexane. Okay, right. So this is our final exercise of this video. If you could have a look at these skeletal formulae and try and name the compounds, pause the video so that you can have a good go at it, and then we'll look at the answers. Okay. Okay, so I'm going to just draw the longest chains for each, and then just so you can double check your answers before we give the final answer. Interesting, this one at the bottom. Doesn't actually matter which way I do that one there, but okay. So then substituents. These would be our substituents. There we go. And then you can pause at any point, by the way, and try and finish it. But anyway, and then thinking about numbering. Actually, it doesn't matter on that top one. I think this must be... correct for that. End. And then the last one. Okay, so I think they're the appropriate numbers. So naming them now. Okay, so 4 carbons, so that's bute, and it's butane because it's saturated, and we have 2,3-dimethyl butane. Okay, the next one. Okay, so we've got 7 carbons in the chain, so heptane. We've got an ethyl group on the fourth and 2 methyl groups on the second. Ethyl comes before methyl in terms of alphabetical order. So that must be 4-ethyl, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, just making sure that's clear. Dimethyl. Heptane. this one at the bottom left. So it's hex. I've got a methyl groups on the second, third, and fourth. So 2, 3, 4 trimethyl hexane. Okay, and then the one on the bottom right, 1, 2, 3, 4. So bute, 2 methyls on the second. So 2, 2 dimethyl butane. Great. Okay, so I hope that's all been reasonably clear, but get in touch if you have any problems or queries. All right, thanks very much.